probably that mic. Okay, hello everyone. Please welcome to the stage Luke Sneeringer, who will be giving us a great introduction to regular expressions.
Thank you. Good morning, it is good to be with you all. I hope you have enjoyed PyCon so far. We put this talk at the beginning in order to allow some of the instructional talks to go first so that there will be more and more value out of the talks later. It's good to see you all here. I'm going to be talking about regular expressions. And really, the first kind of question that needs to be answered is why? This is a Python conference. Regular expressions are not specific to Python. But they are something that lots of programmers use. They're a standard mechanism to find basically a pattern or a block of text within a bigger block of text. They're useful for ensuring formatting consistency, transforming data into a common format, or just general checking for sanity checking, basically, on blocks of text. And it's a skill that's very useful to have. And a surprising number of really very good programmers do not fundamentally understand these. The XKCD comic, comes to mind. When you learn this, you suddenly realize all the places where it is useful, although that particular scenario might be a little bit contrived. There is a perception with regular expressions that is really pretty pervasive, which is basically that they're like big, large dragons, because you look at something like that. And your initial reaction when you look at something like that is basically, what? And then you're just like, I don't understand how you get into this situation. What is going on here? And they're really not actually all that scary. It's not an impossible task. But if you start and go look at the most complicated thing, that's the situation that you're going to have, is just not understanding what's going on. And so my goal with this talk is to go through regular expressions, starting with the simple, and giving building blocks to get into a more complex thing, so at the end, you will understand and be able to parse out the dragon at the end, and we'll come back to that. Before going into regular expressions themselves, I want to talk a little bit about Python's module for dealing with regular expressions, which is the RE module. The RE module is part of the standard library. You don't have to pip install it. You don't have to do anything else. It's been part of the standard library for maybe since the beginning, certainly for a very long time. Unless you're on Python 1, you're going to have this. This is where, again, Python's parsing is done. I tend to have very verbose slides for the use of people looking at them later. Basically, this is your syntax. This is the basic command for doing things with regular expressions, for checking, looking for your needle in your haystack. You import RE, and then you run re.search. A quick PSA that I need to mention, because if you're looking at the Python documentation, a lot of the things will use re.match instead of re.search. At least for now, for the purposes of learning what you're doing, just use re.search. I'll give a quick hand wave to the difference. Re.match requires that the match be at the very, very beginning of the string. Re.search just requires that it be in the string somewhere. Regular expressions has a mechanism for matching against beginning of string. We'll come to that in a little while. And so you get into very confusing situations when you're using re.match and you're like, but this is in the string. Why isn't it working? Well, it's not at the beginning. So just for the purposes of teaching yourself, any time that you see this, just use re.search. You will save yourself a drastic amount of confusion. The rules for re.search are pretty straightforward. If your regex matches, you'll get back a match object. We're going to go into what match objects look like, what their methods are, in a little while. They have a few methods that you'll commonly use, basically group, groups, and group dict. I award no points to whoever named these. And if your regex doesn't match, then re.search is just going to return none. You're not going to get an exception. So basically, you'll want to do an if block check for it most of the time. To my knowledge, there is no way to get an exception for a non-match in the RE module. Another quick aside that I want to make is about Python raw strings. Once my Bluetooth decides to work again. It caught up. Python raw strings are what you get if you prefix a string literal with an R character. The reason that this is important, I don't know how much you guys are familiar with some of the details of string formatting in Python, but of course, in a normal single-quoted or double-quoted string, you can prefix a character with a backslash to escape it. So if you need to, for instance, include a literal single-quote character in a single-quoted string, you can prefix it with a backslash. You can also do that for some Unicode characters and some other things to that effect. If you prefix with a raw a string with an R, then backslashes become just literal backslashes. There is no escaping allowed. This is really, really, really important to you because regexes themselves have their own escaping, and it also uses backslash. And so you end up with a situation where every time you need a regular expression backslash, you need to use two backslashes in your Python string. This is, of course, harder to read. If you need a literal backslash, you need four. Two to backslash it in the regex, times two to get the literal ones from the Python string. So you'll basically make yourself have a much easier to read situation if you use raw strings, prefixing with an R. You'll see that within any examples where any escaping is used. R does not stand for regex, it stands for raw. However, actually, this is such a common use case that a non-trivial number of editors will actually give you regular expression syntax highlighting if you use a raw string. Sublime Text does. Of course, TextMate does because it shares parsing. Now let's talk about regular expressions themselves. The most basic regular expression is really just a string of basically uninteresting literal characters. ABC is a regular expression, and it matches ABC. So remember, read.search, needle, haystack. So the first argument is your regular expression, just the physical characters A, B, and C. The haystack is ABCDEF, and it brings back a match object. Match objects have absolutely atrocious wrappers. I apologize. I didn't do it. That is a regular expression. It's valid. It's well-formed. It doesn't match anything interesting. It's not going to find you any pattern or anything other than the characters A, B, C. If this is what you wanted, you would just do A, B, C in A, B, C, D, E, F. Again, if you're searching for something that doesn't match, you're just going to get back none, which, of course, your interactive Python shell will represent with just nothing. This is simple enough, but completely uninteresting. The next pattern that we're going to look for is repetition. Certain characters placed after a regular expression atomic unit, which so far we've seen one, which is a literal character, will allow for looking for that character repeated. And there's about five different forms of this. This will be a little bit more clear when I get to the example. But if you see a plus, that means that the character or atomic unit is used one or more times. A star means it's used zero or more times. What do I have next? A question mark means zero or one times. The way that you can think of this, it's technically a repetition operator, but if you're trying to make something optional, that's a question mark. Curly brackets with a number inside is exactly that many. If you want exactly two times, exactly three times. Say you're trying to parse a phone number, so you would have three digits. Exactly three, followed by a hyphen, followed by exactly three, followed by a hyphen, followed by exactly four. This might be what you would do. And then the X, comma, Y syntax is for an inclusive range. If you want between three and five occurrences, you would have curly bracket, three, comma, five, close curly bracket. This applies to a single atomic thing. So the regular expression AB bracket two will match ABB. It will not match AB, AB. The A and the B are each atomic units, and the 2 only modifies the atomic unit that immediately precedes it. And as I said a second ago, so far the only atomic thing we've seen is a single literal character. We're about to look at some more. The next thing is character sets. Character sets are if you're trying to match a set of characters, which you do all the time when you're writing regular expressions. Say you want to expect a certain number of letters or a certain number of numbers or letters or numbers. This is how you do it. It matches any single character in the set. Note any single character, one character, and then you use repetition, those repetition operators I gave you a second ago, in order to match an arbitrary length. Here's an example for using a character set. We're trying to match the word gray. Gray has two valid spellings in English, and nobody agrees which one is right, so either of them are okay. This regular expression will match both. It matches a literal G, then a literal R, then either the character A or E, but not both, and then a literal Y. As a note, it is case sensitive. We'll go to that in a minute. So we've seen it matches gray with an A. Now it matches gray with an E, but it doesn't match. I'm not even going to try to pronounce that. It's my own slide. Again, character sets match one single occurrence of a character. I should not have animated that. So you'll see here what it does match. It doesn't match absence, because it's not optional. It doesn't match a different character. It doesn't match the character repeated. It doesn't match both of the characters. It doesn't match something with different case. And it doesn't match something with different case where the case is within the character set. There is a way to do case insensitive regular expressions, but that's not what we're covering. You can also specify ranges in the character set, and you do it with the hyphen character. So I gave an example earlier about matching a phone number. This is a way to match a local phone number with no area code. So 0 through 9, sub 3, 0 through 9, bracket 4, will match 867-5309. That hyphen in the middle is, of course, just a literal character because it's not part of the character set. There are a couple other ways to write this particular thing that we're going to get back to, but so far these are the only blocks I've shown you. Sometimes you actually need a literal hyphen in a character set. You can escape it within the character set. Again, see why you might want raw strings. But you don't actually have to in this case. If you put it at the beginning or the end, it will just be a literal hyphen. So this little block here would match one or more characters either between lowercase a and lowercase z, the 0 character through the 9 character, or a literal hyphen because of that literal hyphen at the end. And this is, at least in my own assessment, the preferred syntax. It's better than escaping. It's drastically easier to read. And an obvious use case I could think of off the top of my head is if you're trying to look at a UUID string representation, that's going to be 32 hexadecimal characters, 0 through 9, A through F, and hyphens. There's a hyphen after the 8th, 12th, 16th, and 20th number or letter, hexadecimal digit. There's also some shortcuts for character classes. I just did A through Z, 0 through 9. There's a couple of these that we see really often, and so there's these things called character classes to deal with them. 0 through 9 is equivalent to backslash D, which is a character class. Again, why you want raw strings. There's a few of these in the Python parser, but there's really 4 common ones, which are the ones I'm going to go over. Backslash W is word characters. This is A through Z, capital or lowercase. It actually does also include 0 through 9 in Python. That's not true in every language, but it is true in Python, which is, of course, why we're here. Slash D is digits, numeral characters, 0 through 9. Backslash S is white space characters, space, tab, new line. You're going to have a lot of situations if you're validating form input where you cannot rely on people to use consistent spacing. So a backslash S will get you any kind of white space. And also is, of course, very useful with your plus or your star for just getting rid of or parsing out arbitrary amounts of white space. And then slash B is word boundary characters. This actually includes lack of a character. It includes something like beginning of string or end of string. The purpose of this is basically matching whole words. Let's say that you want to match. I'm trying to think of an example off the top of my head, which is of course foolish. Let's say that you want to match my name Luke, but not lukewarm. The word lukewarm, slash B Luke slash B would match just my name, And in fact, in my work company chat, that's the alert that I have set up, because I don't want to match something that just happens to have my name inside it. This alone is actually pretty sufficient for finding simple patterns. An example would be this one. I'm going to go over it very quickly. I'm still good on time. I have 10 minutes. So this is an arbitrary number of word characters or the physical space, one or more, followed by a literal comma, followed by two capital letter characters, followed by two spaces, two physical spaces, followed by a letter, space, a letter, a number. Can anyone tell me what this is trying to match? Anybody? Very good, thank you. It is a Canadian postal code. So this is Montreal, Quebec, H2Z1X7, which is the postal code that we're in right now. Okay, let's go a little bit farther into intermediate. Character sets can also support negations. Sometimes you want to match characters that are in a set. Sometimes you want to match any character that isn't in a set. This is done by using a hat character to begin the set. Oh, whoops, sorry. Important note here. Having a negated character class does not match the absence of those characters. It matches the presence of a character that is not those characters. Those are not the same thing. This regular expression right here, ABC hat D, will not match ABC. There is no character after that to make the match, so this will return none. This will, in fact, return something. It will match the A, the B, the C, and this is very important, and the X. It's checking for the presence of a character that is not D. There is something called look ahead, including negative look ahead, that will allow you to check for the absence of a character. I'm actually not going into that in this presentation. I won't have time. But it's something you can look up very easily online. Another thing to mention is special characters, either in character sets or not in character sets, sorry, but outside of them. A hat matches beginning of string or beginning of line, depending on how your regex is set up. Dollar sign matches end of string and end of line. So that matches. That still matches because the ABC is at the beginning of the string. That doesn't because the string continues. That dollar sign means that it needs to be at end of string or end of line, and DEF violates that. So the entire thing doesn't match at all. So far, I've shown you how to match patterns. What I haven't shown you how to do is pull the matches out. You sometimes really only care about formatting consistency. Did the user enter something that looks right? Okay, just save it all. If you want to pull the pieces out, you need introspection. Quickest, easiest thing to do is introspecting the full match. Get me the whole thing I asked for. The method for that is .group. So here we have a regular expression. We're looking for a phone number. I've added an area code now. And I have a string down here, which is the string that we're, you know, our haystack. So some garbage at the beginning, some garbage at the end, and then we have our phone number in the middle. We see that it did match because I have, you know, I've printed into my console and I have a match object with a terrible wrapper. Now I can run my group method on it. When I do that, I get the full match, but not anything around it. So I have my phone number and nothing else, because that's all the regular expression matched. It didn't match against end of string or beginning of string or anything like that. So it pulled part of the string and pulled it out. You can actually get even a little bit more into the weeds than that. You can do what's called back references. This is for getting subsets or pieces of your match. We call them back references because we want to feel very smart, because we know what the name is and you do not. But really, this is just a fancy name for putting subsets of your regex in parentheses. I gave you this example earlier that the gentleman in the back correctly identified as being a postal code. What if I want to pull out just the city or the state or the zip? Postal code, this is Canada. Some of those things are pretty easy. Pulling out the postal code, it's always going to be at the end, et cetera. The city is a little bit more interesting. Regular expressions are our tool for that. So I've added back references here. I've added parentheses around the city name. I'm going to drop the comma. I've added parentheses around the province name. And I've added parentheses around the postal code. I think I said state several times. Apologies for my Canadian friends. So here's my regex combined into two lines. I do have a backslash. I grayed out so as not to be distracting, just for reasons of the slide. Here we can see that it's matching. It's matching my, you know, Montreal, Quebec in our zip code. You can get the group, which is just the string we had before. Now you can get groups. Note the plural. And that separates out the groups into their back references. So match.group sub 0 would be just Montreal. Match.group sub 1 would be QC. Match.group sub 0 or sub 2 is the postal code. In addition to that, this is very useful most of the time. Sometimes it's actually valuable to name them. If you use Django's URL routing, you've probably done this more than once because it matches the keyword arguments of the method name. Python actually added, back in the late 90s, an extension to Perl-compatible regular expressions, which is what we're learning, to have named back references. This syntax has actually been ported to lots of other languages. It's almost universal at this point. But it's a kind of a goofy syntax. You add question mark P, angle bracket, and then your name to the beginning of the back reference. The question mark P, I think, I'm not completely sure, but I think it's because it was originally a Python extension. So here's our example that we just went over. We all saw it for getting a postal code. Let's add named back references to them. I'm going to have a line break in the middle of this just because otherwise it would be too small for anyone to read. So pretend that line break is just two spaces for me. We'll pretend and it'll all be good. So now I'm parsing out the city, the province, and the postal code into these segments. So here is again, in valid Python code, I've abbreviated postal to PC because, again, space. The line breaks there are valid. Okay, so again, we're running our search. We got our group earlier. We've all seen that. There's our groups. They're still there. The numbered back references are still valid, even if they're named in Python. That's not true in every language. If you run the group dict method, you actually get a dictionary back with your named back references as keys and the value of your string as values. Very, very, very simple. And you just take that dictionary and reference it like, well, a dictionary. So let's go back to that dragon. Let's wrap up. We've got about two more minutes. Wrap up with that. So this is the dragon I gave you earlier. I've now introduced everything here. I'm not going to ask if anyone recognizes what this is. I expect some do. But I am going to go over it. So first of all, note the word boundaries on each of the sides. That's to make sure that this is an atomic unit in a block of text. We expect either spaces, beginning of string, a tab, something. Now we have some valid characters here. A to Z, well, I actually made a mistake here because this should have been a case-insensitive regex. Apologies. So pretend that that's A to Z and then lower A to Z. So A to Z, 0 to 9, a period character, underscore, percent, plus, or hyphen. It's one or more of those characters. At least one can be an arbitrary number. Terminated by an at sign, which is what it expects to come next. And then a smaller subset of characters, one or more, A to Z, 0 through 9, a period or a hyphen. That is a physical period. It's escaped. Something I didn't actually go over in my slides is that a period matches any character in regular expressions. It's a character class that I missed. So you need to escape it to get a physical period. And then A to Z only between 2 and 4 characters. This is a regular expression to match an email address. So something at something.com, org, foo, mill, whatever. It will match almost every valid email address. The exception to that rule is .museum is actually a TLD, and it will not match that because museum is 6 characters long. Anybody know anyone with the .museum email address? Yeah, me neither. I have not gone over everything that there is to know about regular expressions. I've really just tried to give you the fundamental building blocks. Start simple and build up. There's a ton more for interesting situations. You won't get in them as often, but you do see them. Alternation is basically like foo or bar. Look ahead. I mentioned look ahead earlier when I was talking about matching a negation of a character class. If you really do need to just match absence, look ahead is how it's done. And conditionals, which is basically if-then. If-then is not recommended in regular expressions. It's generally pretty unwise. It's better to do that in your Python interpreter, but it can be done if you have a good reason. At this point, my talk is concluded. I'll gladly take your questions. We have about 4 minutes. So if anyone has any questions, please feel free to walk up to the mic. And my wonderful session chair will proctor.
So you matched a phone number, but what if in your haystack there's 10 phone numbers and you want them all?
Great question. To repeat it, he said, so I showed an example of matching a phone number. What happens if you have 10 of them and you want to show them all? There's a Boolean flag that you can add in your search. I'm blanking on what it is right now, but it's a constant. I think it's re.matchall. Matchall is in all caps because it's a constant. Don't quote me on that. I might be wrong. It's on the re-documentation page. As soon as you do that, the output of these methods changes slightly. Groups and group dict all change a little bit. Yes, exactly. I think a tuple, actually, but principle remains. And you get them all in order. Right now, on any of these examples, you would get the first one. As soon as you do that, you get all of them, and you can iterate over them. And I think it's re.match_all, but I wouldn't swear to it. It's actually worth noting, I'm going to use that to segue into another statement, which is, we were talking case sensitivity. There's a flag for that. I don't remember what it is, but that's how you get a case insensitive regex. So my A to Z there would have worked. And if you need some combination thereof, you use logical operators, your pipe or your ampersand. Well, you never use ampersand, actually, just pipe. They're numbers, but they're bitwise numbers. So pipe is slightly more accurate. Anyone else? Thank you all for coming.